love-hate relationship with setting up and tearing down those days. I hated that we had to do it. I loved the reason why we did it. And so I remember St. Patrick's Day parades. Any of you guys remember those days, St. Patrick's Day parade? I remember we were part of the, Journey Church was part of the Elmhurst St. Patrick's Day parade, the largest St. Patrick's Day parade outside the city of Chicago in Illinois. And we had a float and we had our band playing some music and it was exciting. And we passed out candy and we passed out toys and stuff like that to the people there that had our name and website on it. And it was awesome and it was fun. And the best part of that, and I kid you not, is every year we got these big full-size candy bars that we would give to the adults, right? And I can't tell you how many adults were so excited. Like, you think it was Christmas morning, okay? We'd give them a full candy bar. It was like a full candy bar, and they went crazy. Like, I felt like Santa Claus handing out these full candy bars to grown adults. Either that, or they were really, really drunk, and they didn't really know what I was giving them. So that could have been true, too. I remember... Man, so many memories. I remember our first baptisms. We baptized people at the Waterford Conference Center in the early days, within the first 6 months, and we used the same water trough, portable water trough that we used today. And I remember that first Sunday, we hadn't figured out, or at least I hadn't figured out, the temperature of the water, managing that. And so about 3 hours before the service, I went in and into the hotel, and I used the hot water heater there and the direct line from that, and piped in hot water because it was cold outside. I wanted to make sure it was warm and not cold, and it was hot, but I was like, don't worry, 3 hours, it's going to cool down. I had underestimated how long it took for that to cool down. In fact, there's pictures that you can see online of people getting baptized and steam is just rising from the baptistry, right? They're getting out of the baptistry. I mean, they're saved and they're baptized and they're all good, but their face and their arms and their legs, red as possible. Like they're going in like, this is hot, you know? And I can't believe we didn't get a lawsuit for third degree burns baptizing people. We slowly but surely figured out the temperature management of that. I remember, and I've been thinking about this a lot over the last couple weeks, I remember we had a launch team of about 16 to 18 people before we publicly launched Journey Church Worship Services, and we were getting a little antsy, and so we decided, you know what, let's just start worshiping. Let's just start getting together, because we hadn't really done anything that formal together, and so we decided we were going to do Journey Light. Which simply meant it wasn't really anything but a little bit of music and some preaching. And we had a small office downtown Elmhurst, and so we decided to do that. And I think our record attendance at the office those 6 weeks was 16 people. We did have Dunkin' Donuts, but we had the donut holes because it's Journey Light, right? And we just had an acoustic guitar, and I preached of those 6 weeks leading up to our launch. And what we were doing during those 6 weeks, and I think it's important for you to understand, is those 6 weeks, we were actually studying the book of Acts in the Bible. This thrilling book that recounts the story of how God's church got started and what they did and what they valued and how the communities around them took hold of this very first church. And as we were studying those 6 weeks, our goal was not to just say we want to be just like that first century church. Our goal wasn't to be a carbon copy of that first century church, because we really believe that we had been called by God not to be a first century church in America, but to be a 21st century church in America. And so we were like, we just want to learn from this early church. We want to glean some wisdom. We want to be inspired. We want to be encouraged. And although there was just a handful of us, and some of you guys were actually there in that room, there was just a handful of us, we got a clear picture and a clear vision of what God wanted for Journey Church. So for my final sermon here at Journey, I ask that you would allow me to come full circle and to go back to read in the Bible, in the book of Acts, the very first words ever written about God's church as Journey Church heads into a new season of ministry and what God has store for them. It's found in Acts chapter 2, starting in verse 42. And some of you have been in church for a long time. You probably have many of these verses memorized. You probably have heard it hundreds, if not thousands of times. But hopefully, I want to leave you this morning with some inspiration and some challenge and some hope about God's plans for Journey Church. Here we go. Acts chapter 2, starting in verse 42. The first words ever written describing that first church. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, the sharing of meals, including the Lord's Supper and the prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and great generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. One of the most inspiring and dynamic descriptions of the church that you will ever find. And there is so much in these six verses. There's a lot going on. In fact, so much that I could do an 8-week series just on these six verses. But if I could just sum up all that I just read, all that's happening in this very first church that ever existed in the first century, if I could just sum it up this way, allow me to do that, is the people, these followers of Jesus, they were fully engaged with what God was doing among them. As I read these six verses, and I've read them hundreds and thousands of times, I come away with this. These people, these followers of Jesus, they were new in their faith, they were new in the community, but man, they saw God move, they saw God do incredible things, and they were fully engaged with what was happening. I mean, God, through Jesus Christ, was transforming lives, and everyone was engaged. Everyone understood that we're all in with this. This is ours. Which is surprising for some of them, probably, because just months earlier, some of them in this group probably hadn't even heard of Jesus. Some had. In fact, probably many of them had heard of Jesus, but they'd never seen Jesus firsthand. Some of them there, no doubt, had seen Jesus from a distance, but this was taking it to a whole nother level. These people were experiencing the power of Jesus Christ firsthand as his church. Man, they were fully engaged. And as I read this over and over again, it's clear these people, they weren't just playing church. No, they weren't just doing their religious duty and then going home and getting about life. They were committed to the calling that Jesus had given his church and the mission. They were all in with Jesus and the mission and the relationships and the community. Man, this brings me back to the early days of Journey Church and the dreams that I had for Journey Church. I've always believed this to be true, that there is nothing more beautiful and more powerful than a group of Jesus followers who will not settle for sitting on the sidelines as they pursue Jesus and do it as a faith community. Nothing more incredible than people who are fully engaged within a faith community and God is working among them. From day one, that's been my dream here at Journey Church, that as a faith community, that we would fully engage with the presence and the power of God displayed among us in ways we never thought possible. But you need to understand, that doesn't happen by accident. It doesn't just happen by accident. In fact, as you read this description of that very first church, they were intentional. It's clear they were intentional. They were intentional about pursuing Jesus. They were intentional about pursuing his mission. They were intentional about pursuing it together. And as I've read this passage of Scripture over and over again, especially in preparation for my final sermon here at Journey Church, I've got to tell you, there are words and there are phrases in this short description of the early church that just jump out to me. And God has spoken to me and said, this is what you need to share with Journey Church. So allow me to do some of that this morning. Just, they jump out to me like they never have before. Look again at how it all starts out, this description. All the believers devoted themselves. They devoted themselves. Now, that word in the original language literally means to persevere. Isn't that interesting? It's not just a devotion or a commitment to something. Yeah, that's part of it, but there's some meaning that's been lost in the translation. Actually, the word means they persevered. Why would the writer use that word? Because that is what you do when you believe in a cause worth living for. You persevere. You don't stop. You don't quit. You don't give up. Now, it sounds all good right now for this early church, but you need to understand that in the days ahead, they would have so much opposition and so many obstacles. But they, the Bible says, persevered. They never gave up, even when it was inconvenience for them, even when it got messy, even when it got hard. They never gave up. God was faithful to them. See, I believe any movement of God that is going to make an impact, that is going to make a difference in this world, will need to persevere. In Journey's short 10-year history, we've had to persevere a lot. We've had financial obstacles throughout the years. We've had personnel. We've had leaders change, come in and come out. We've had all kinds of challenges. We've had different locations. And sometimes the first couple years, if you remember, we had to change from the big space to the small space downstairs. And there have been so many challenges. Remember, some of you guys, we were homeless for about 6 weeks before we moved into here. I remember it was late fall and we were in tents and heaters, and it was 40 degrees outside in Chicagoland and raining. And we've had all kinds of obstacles, and we've had to persevere. But guess what? God has been faithful. God has been faithful. See, that's what happens when you persevere. And the early church was beginning to discover that. They persevered. The Bible says they devoted themselves. They were committed to the cause. And I don't believe that it is by chance that the very first thing that Luke, who writes this book, Acts, I don't believe it's by chance that the very first thing that he said they devoted themselves, they committed themselves to, they persevered with, was what? The apostles' teaching. Now, you need to understand that in those days, that would have meant something maybe different than maybe we think of today, or maybe at least a little bit differently. The apostles, their teaching, it wasn't about moral rules or regulations to follow. They weren't teaching Old Testament history. They weren't teaching the stories of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And they weren't teaching about Moses. They weren't teaching about Noah. They weren't teaching about Elijah. They weren't teaching some kind of doctrine or the hot topics of their day. They weren't teaching religious behavioral modifications or their thoughts on government and political ideology. No. What they were teaching to these people, this very first church, was their firsthand experience with Jesus Christ. That's all. You see, because what made an apostle in those days, the way you became an apostle in those days, you actually didn't become an apostle, you were just one, because those are the ones who lived with Jesus for 3.5 years. These were the ones who saw Jesus with their very own eyes. They heard Jesus with their very own ears. They understood Jesus. They were with him. They experienced him so they could tell anyone and everyone, this is who Jesus is. And so that's what they taught the people. Jesus' life, we saw it. Jesus' power, we saw him walk on water. We saw him calm the storm. We saw it all. They taught Jesus and his life and his hope and his truth and his love. That's it. That's the apostles' teaching. And man, the church couldn't get enough of it. The more they heard about Jesus, the more they wanted of Jesus. And in those early days of the church, they understood that the foundation of everything they were to do was to be the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. It was the spiritual catalyst, and it made all the difference in the world. And it still does. So here's my first challenge for Journey Church. And this will probably not be a surprise to most of you. Continue to point people to Jesus. I mean, you've heard me say it hundreds of times. But continue to point people to Jesus. Empower people to live and love like Jesus. There is no doubt, Journey, that we have good music here on a weekly basis, but don't point people to our music. We have good preaching here. We have great children's programs. We have great first impressions. We have a great facility. We have great coffee and bagels and donuts, but do not point people to those things. Point people to Jesus Christ. And I promise you, Journey Church will be here long after any of us are still around. Point people to Jesus. Don't lose that focus, church. Don't be tempted to shift your attention to some new cool program or idea or strategy. Don't get involved with all the craziness of our world and the politics and the government and try to shape the church around what we think it should be based on some specific political or government worldview. Don't get caught up in all the debates and the division and the hatred and the anger and talk of the day. Point people to Jesus, because he is and will always be the hope of this world. Point people to Jesus, and you can't go wrong. And that's what was happening. The apostles were pointing people to Jesus, and it couldn't be contained. So they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. They persevered. Even when it got tough, they stuck with Jesus. Notice it says, all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper and to prayer. Now, here's the deal. Some of you guys, that word fellowship, if you grew up in church or if you've been in church for a long time, that word has maybe a different meaning to us. And some of you guys are like, I don't really know what that word means. But for me, growing up, probably the first 25, 30 years of my life, fellowship, every time I saw that word, every time I read that word in the Bible, I would think of one thing and one thing only. Food, okay? I don't know. I mean, most things make me think of food, okay? It's not just that word, but fellowship, like I grew up in churches and I've been a part of churches that they have a fellowship hall. Any of you guys know what I'm talking about? It's usually in the basement, and it's usually dreary, and it usually gets flooded a couple times a year. But that's another story. But there's fellowship halls, right? And that's where people come and they eat and they socialize. And so fellowship is sort of an aspect of church. Like, hey, let's go fellowship. We're gonna fellowship. We're gonna have a potluck dinner. We're gonna go out to eat. We're gonna go down to the fellowship hall and do some fellowshipping, type of thing like that. The problem is we've made fellowship as an aspect of church when it really is the church. It is the DNA of God's church, of the church of Jesus Christ. The original word here is koinonia. It's Greek. You don't need to know that. But it's this idea of sharing together as a gathering of people. In other words, this is how I would translate it. This is the idea behind this word fellowship. It's participating in a faith community. So in the original language, it's actually, they devote themselves to fellowship almost in our English language, ... Here's how they did that. It wasn't they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, and then to these other things. No, fellowship, sharing together, was how they did church. They shared their lives together. In other words, they were participants, not spectators. So, church, another challenge from your pastor this morning is choose participation over consumption. Choose participation over consumption. Don't settle for coming here on a Sunday morning and sitting in a chair and consuming spiritual goods and services. You come here and say, what's in it for me today? How can you encourage me? How can you challenge me? How can you inspire me? Don't settle for that. Don't settle for, hey, you know what? I don't feel like being a part of church today. I don't feel like serving today. The weather's horrible outside, or maybe the weather's really nice outside and I have something better else to do. And so I'll just watch them online, and I'll watch them online next week and the next week. Boy, it's so nice and convenient. I can just be a part of the church online. Listen, understand this. That is just spiritual consumption. All you're doing on a regular basis when you're at home watching a video is you're just consuming spiritual goods and services. Now, there are times when we're sick or we're out on vacation that is great, and that's great technology. But never confuse that with church. Choose participation over consumption. Participate in what God is doing here. Serve. Invest relationally in each other. Be involved outside of Sunday morning worship services. Engage with each other and in the mission and vision that God has called Journey Church to be about. See, I believe the greatest tragedy of American Christianity is that we have adopted the consumer mentality of our culture. And some of my last words are, understand this, church was never meant to be a place where people come and consume spiritual goods and services. The church is the people. And we are to participate actively and share in what God is doing among us. Here's something else that just has jumped out to me. In these last days, verse 43, it says this, a deep sense, I love this description, a deep sense of awe came over everyone. And the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. I love that. I mean, God was moving. The power of Jesus was flowing through the apostles and through the church. People were healed physically. People who could never walk started walking. People who could never see started seeing. People who had leprosy were cleansed. People who were sick and dying were made well. I mean, people were healed left and right. It wasn't just a one-time thing. Over and over and over again, they were constantly experiencing the supernatural power of God among them. No longer was the power of Jesus just a hypothetical to them. Oh, yeah, I heard that Jesus turned water into wine. I heard that Jesus brought someone back from the dead. Now it was a reality in everyone's life who are part of that church. They were experiencing the power of Jesus firsthand. And every time, they were in awe. They were blown away. And here's what I love. As we read more and more about the early church, this awe of God's power, the power of Jesus flowing through them, it never got old. In fact, not only did it never get old, but they came to expect it. Like they came into gatherings like this saying, okay, what's God going to do today? Like we serve a big God. What is he going to do today among us? It was just a part of their church's culture. It's what happened when they came together. And they expected God to move in big ways, and guess what? He did every time. So church, here's another challenge I have for us, is expect God's power to be present. Just expect it. It should be the norm. Expect God to move in big ways as a part of this church. As God is moving in us, expect God to move because we serve a big God. Amen. We serve the creator of the universe. Expect that power to be displayed among his people in this faith community. Pray for it. Make room for it. Be desperate for it. And I promise you, God will show up and you will stand in awe. I was thinking about that this week. Like, when was the last time that you were awed? Like, you were just blown away and wowed in a good way, not a bad way. I think it takes a lot, especially in the culture that we live in today. It takes a lot to be awed, to be wowed. But within the church, we should be awed on a regular basis, right? Because we serve a big God. All that people are being healed, not just physically, but just as important, emotionally, spiritually, relationally. We should be in awe. We should expect that when we come here, marriages are going to be saved. When we come together and we focus on Jesus and point people to Jesus, we should expect that God will move and that people will go from death to life. We should have come here and we should expect the presence of God to do something so amazing that addictions will be wiped away, sins will be cleared, baggage from your past will be wiped away and you'll be able to unload it, that lives will be transformed, that relationships will be restored, that people's lives will be redeemed over and over and over again. Every time we get together, every time we come together, the Bible says that where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them. When the church comes together, God moves. And if you don't think that that is important, that we should expect it, one of the scariest verses in the Bible, it says that Jesus was unable to do miracles in his own hometown. Well, that's weird. That's bizarre. I thought Jesus could do anything. The Bible says Jesus could not do miracles in his own hometown. Not because he couldn't, not because he didn't have the power, not because he didn't want to. Why? The Bible says because they didn't have faith. They didn't expect it. And so Jesus said, I'll go somewhere else. Listen, church, never underestimate the power of God released within an expectant faith community. One final thing jumped out to me. And it's easy for a pastor to have this one stick out, but maybe it's a little bit different today. Verse 47. This beautiful description, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day, the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. They went from a handful of people to a church of over 5,000. Now it's clear, as the writer of Luke says, that the Lord added to their number. It was God who made it grow. The Bible clearly says that. There is no growth strategy in the world or vision that is going to force God's hand. God is the one who brings the people. So be ready, church. And here's the deal. As God is adding to people, because lives were being changed, and they were telling their friends, they were telling their neighbors, they were telling everyone and anyone. And God was bringing the people to experience this firsthand. Now, that part was the hardest part, and that's God. God does that. God grows. God adds the people. But here's the deal. The church had to accept those people. They had to welcome those people. They had to say, come on in. You're a part of us now. But they didn't have to. They could have said, you know what? Man, we're getting really, really big. I don't think we have enough room for you. We don't have enough homes to meet in. Or they could have said, you know what? You're a Gentile. Or we know you're a sinner. You're a prostitute. You're a tax collector. You're a cheat. I don't think you really should be here. This is for holy people. I mean, they could have said all of that as more and more people, they could have said, we didn't want to be this big, but no, they didn't. They welcomed them. God brought the people, but they welcomed them. They met them right where they're at. And they grew by thousands. So be ready, church. My final challenge to Journey Church. And if you don't remember anything else, other than point people to Jesus, remember this, build a longer table, not a higher wall. Build a longer table, not a higher wall. Journey, play your part in expanding God's kingdom here on planet Earth. So many of your friends, so many of your family, so many of your neighbors and coworkers are far from God and living away from Jesus and have no hope. God will bring the people. God will use us, though, and when he does, be ready, church. Have open arms to welcome anyone and everyone who comes into these doors, who comes into this building, who comes into one of our gatherings. Be ready, church. As they come in, meet them right where they're at. Don't judge them. Don't alienate them. Don't look down on them. Don't debate with them. Just meet them right where they're at, whatever it is, just like we all met each other flawed and imperfect and messed up and had doubts and questions. We meet each other right where we're at. That's what we are to do, and we're to point people to Jesus. And then when it gets to the point where you're like, we got too many people, and these people over here, I'm not sure they really should be at church. When the table gets too crowded, what you do is you extend the table. You build a longer table so everyone has a seat at the seat with Jesus Christ. I think we'd all agree, we don't need higher walls. We don't need walls in our culture. We have enough walls that divide us and bring disunity. My prayer for Journey Church is that you would continue to be a wall-less church that is happy to expand and extend the table longer and longer and longer to be there for more and more people to help them bump into Jesus. I truly believe that the best days of Journey Church are ahead. It has been an honor and a thrill to pastor you over these 10 years. It's been incredible, life-changing, and faith-altering. And God has been faithful through it all. I wouldn't change it for the world. So just know this, Journey Church. Even though I'll be 10,000 miles apart, you will always be in my heart. You will always be on my heart. So until we meet again, Pastor out.
So I have to follow that. Real quick, guys, not too much time. Just wanted to say thanks for coming. Again, thank you, Steve, and the Baker family for everything you've done for us for the past 10 years. Wow. Just two things. Reminder that if you signed up, we're going to have a little going-away dinner for the Bakers, 5 to 7 tonight. If you got a half hour to get here earlier to help set up a few tables, that would be awesome. Never turn down help. And then quick update on our interim pastor search. We've received about 8 resumes to date. They were closing off the time to submit resumes Thursday next week. So we should be able to make a decision here quickly after that. We've got some good choices to look at. And then next week, Dave, who I think you guys have seen before, Dave's going to be taking care of us, at least for Sunday morning stuff, starting next week. Hope you all have a great day, and see you tonight.
Every time I try to does life hit you so hard that you've been knocked down? Have you gone too far to find the middle ground?